mundane subject. It's not about ecstatic freedom or bliss or all of which is great, you know, the luminous body and something very down to earth, which is about congruence, about integrity, about walking our talk, but more importantly, not just our talk, but our knowing. Really living what it is that we most deeply know with increasing refinement, with increasing alignment as well. So really looking at incongruence, ways that our living may not be in accord with our knowing. So full disclosure, one of the ways my living is not in accord with my knowing is that I started doing all this preparation for this talk, and the strategic mind wanting to, you know, remember all the important points and get them in the right order. And it just wasn't working. You know, it's like, this is not happening. And there was a little struggle that went on around that. And then there was just a letting go. It's like, you know, this is about sharing. Sharing in a not necessarily orderly or elegant way, but in an authentic way. And so I felt a sense of alignment with that kind of trust, actually, in the process of seeing what the moment brings with this topic. So I wanted to do a little bit of framing, a little frame, and then something experiential, and then open it up to questions and answers and conversation. So I've been talking on this subject of incongruity, closing the gap between our deepest knowing and our daily life for the last few months, several open circle talks in the Bay Area. And I came across a quote by Suzuki Roshi that I particularly like, which was, he said, many of you have probably heard this, he said, you are perfect the way you are. You are perfect the way you are. And you can use a little improvement. Isn't that a great koan? You know, and doesn't it ring true as well? It's like, how does that work? You know, we are perfect as we are, and we can use a little improvement. What is he pointing to? What is Suzuki Roshi pointing to? Because I think he threads the needle beautifully, just like hits the nail on the head in including our full dimensionality, transcendent and immanent. We're perfect as we are. We are whole, already whole, not through any effort at all. It is our birthright. There's nothing to do. In fact, we cannot create our wholeness. All creativity comes from our wholeness. So we are already whole. What a relief, isn't it? It's like all this self-improvement and trying to better ourselves and heal ourselves, and all of which has its value, no mistake. But can you really feel, like, if you really let in, I am whole already, as I am. Just what a relief that is. And we can use a little improvement, right? Because we are highly conditioned human beings, right? From infinite directions, right? And our actions sometimes don't line up with our knowing, with our deep knowing. Has anyone had that experience? Come on, be more honest. Let's save our heads here. All right, let's get real. Yeah, it is about getting real, right? It's not about hiding. It's not, you know, it's like, you know, how well or not well do our public and private lives actually align with our deepest knowing, this knowing of our wholeness, right? And how do we sense when we're kind of out of congruence with that? And most importantly, how are we with that when we notice our incongruence? When it feels, something feels off inside, off the mark. Something doesn't feel right. And it's not for some moralistic reason. It's not that the judging mind is saying, you know, you're bad or you're wrong. It's subtler than that. It's just feeling something unclear, something off, right? How are we with that? Because we can so easily get into the self-improvement project. I'll work on that, right? I'll fix that. I'll make myself better. But with that approach, there's always some element of manipulation, some non-acceptance, even if we're cultivating a so-called mindfulness, which is great to cultivate mindfulness, more open, neutral, warm, curious, affectionate response to our experience. But the conditioned mind cannot accept unconditionally. It just can't do it. It's not in its bag of tricks. The conditioned mind accepts conditionally. I will accept this difficult experience that I'm having, internally or externally, if it ends real quick, right? Like, you're welcome in the front door, and there's the back door, right? For a 5-minute visit. We bargain, we strategize, when we come from that. When we come from that. But if we approach our experience, our incongruities, from presence, it's a very different experience. So that's what I wanted to talk about today. Not so much working on ourselves, but actually how to be graceful with ourselves, how to be graceful with our conditioning in a way that's facilitative, in a way that's natural, in a way that's non-manipulative and non-strategic as well. This is an important part of the awakening process. A lot of accent on awakening is on the waking up out of form, waking up out of identification, right? With our thoughts, with our stories, with our images, and opening to the reality of our unbounded nature, our infinite unbounded nature. This is a tremendous revelation and recognition. And it's also the beginning of a whole nother process of waking down, of awareness dropping down more and more deeply into the body, down and in. And this is actually where most of our identification resides, our attachments and identifications. Yes, in our thinking, absolutely, but even more so in our feeling and in our sensing. It's like an iceberg, right? So initial awakenings are beautiful and glimpses, but what's most important is the continuation of this awakening process. And we can support it or we can obstruct it, depending on our understanding and our beliefs. Like, if we think it's just everything is about, you know, the absolute and unbounded formless awareness, we're going to be dismissive of our feelings, our sensations, our relationships, which are so important in the lived experience of being a human being, right? We can be overtly or subtly dismissive. So it's important to, this movement of awakening is actually quite spontaneous. However, we can slow it down, or we can support it. And the supporting is partially understanding the importance of this descent of awareness through the body, the importance of immanence, right? The balance of transcendence and immanence, of knowing ourselves as both infinite and in finite form, simultaneously, multidimensionally. And the deeper awareness drops down into the body from the head to the heart, which is itself a kind of pilgrimage, right? We talk about pilgrimages. This is the great pilgrimage from here to here, a radical interior pilgrimage, and then a dropping down further. And so we go from the mental to the emotional to the instinctual levels. And what do we encounter? We encounter experiences of terror and instinctual drives for safety, for sexuality, for power and control. And this is very often areas where we're less awake, right? This is where we tend to go to sleep in these areas, and often they get triggered in relationship. So it's a very important exploration. Critically important if we're going to live an embodied life. Right? If we're going to live this awareness, not just sit on our, you know, meditation cushions or go to retreats, but live it in our day-to-day lives. This is the challenge as Westerners, it seems to me. Bring this understanding into our ordinary daily lives. And it's a process. But it's not something for the strategic mind to manipulate. It really can't. But we can cooperate. So as this awareness process of awareness, the descent of awareness happens, it tends to flush out shadowy material, material that we really is uncomfortable, that we don't want to face or look at. And yet in these shadows, you know, are tremendous treasures, buried treasures, essential qualities of being that really infuse our lives as they're liberated. It's like everything wants to be liberated. Everything wants to discover its true nature. Each of you wants to discover your true nature and live it, and everything inside of you that's been pushed away and rejected also wants to be welcomed, wants to be liberated, and has a gift to bear. You'll have to find out what those gifts are. But you will find them, I guarantee you. And will feel more vibrantly awake and alive as a result. So it's a challenge. This is a challenging process to engage in, and it requires vulnerability and honesty, self-honesty. That's the getting real part. Stop pretending. Notice what we're actually experiencing intimately. So let me guide a little meditation here, then we can talk about it. So most of you, I imagine, are sitting comfortably, but if you're not, please do. Feel your feet on the floor. If you'd like, you can close your eyes and take a few deep breaths. And just settle in. You can forget everything I said. That's something my teacher Jean Klein would always say, is, forget everything I said. And we go with your direct experience. So feel yourself held. Feel the weight of your body being held by the chair. you can relax a little. Breathe a little more deeply. The weight of your body held by the chair, your feet touching the floor held by the ground. The ground is part of the earth. So this is a letting yourself be physically held, noticing if there's some efforting to hold up or hold in. Most of us feel some of that subtly, at least. And I invite you to relax, realize you don't need to. So letting yourself be held physically, but also by awareness. We cannot experience anything without awareness, without knowing of it. And so your whole experience, your sensations, your thoughts, your feelings are also being held, held in awareness. This is like infinitely spacious holding. And it's also luminous. There's a quality of light to this inner knowing. So you're also being held in light. Field of light. And there's a deeply loving aspect to this awareness, a deeply heartfelt quality to this awareness. That's also holding you. So it's like being bathed in warm, loving light. The light of awareness. And you are this light of awareness. You are this knowing. You are this which holds everything. Notice the impact of your body. Sensing, breathing. Feeling the sense of presence all around you, as you, through you. Feeling the impact on your body and your mind. So we're attuning with presence now. Loving, light-filled, clear, spacious, radiant. And then notice if there are any aspects of your experience, any actions, any sensations, any feelings that actually want to be liberated. This is not a question for the mind. This is not about looking for a problem. It's actually being available for whatever your experience is right now that wants to be welcomed in. and liberated. You may feel this somatically, you may feel it emotionally, there may be images of certain behaviors that have been difficult for you. It'll be different for each of you. It may be some combination of thought, sensation, feeling, and image. And you welcome whatever this experience is, without an agenda to change. This is not to fix anything or change anything or achieve anything. Simply experiencing what it's like to welcome your conditioned experience into this luminous, loving awareness. So you're breathing, feeling your body, but just observing. Sensing, breathing. It's a little bit like putting the dirty dishes in the soapy warm water. Whatever's wanting to be liberated, whatever's wanting to be seen, whatever's wanting to be felt, whatever's wanting to be recognized or understood, comes forward. And it may be enough to continue sitting with this in this way, or there may be an inquiry if there's a particular sensation or experience that is asking to be known better. You can simply ask yourself, what's in the very center of this? For instance, if there's a somatic contraction, what's in the very center of this? Not to change it, but simply to be intimate. This is all about becoming intimate with your experience. And if there's a problematic behavior, you may want to ask yourself, what is it that I really want? What is it that I'm really wanting? And you drop these questions in and you let them go. They're very innocent. You're not asking your mind. And you listen, and you feel, and you sense. Does anything else want to be welcomed in? Anything else want to be liberated? Revealed. And we'll take another minute. Okay, and take a little while to bring your attention out. Take your time. If you're in the middle of a kind of deep exploration, I invite you to stay with it in the remaining minutes that we have. And this is an inquiry that you can also continue, of course, outside of our meeting too, if you feel drawn to. In the work, if we're counseling, you know, on any level, really, even professionally as a psychiatrist or psychologist or so important that we have, or at least are engaged in this process of being authentic in ourself. And naturally, working with people will expose these incongruities within ourselves. We'll like, oh, there is a reaction, or there is a reflection of something that I haven't quite faced in myself. So in fact, they're learning opportunities, right? We're not looking for perfection here, even though Suzuki Roshi says that we're perfect. Right, so there's something humbling about it, and it becomes an opportunity then for our own exploration. We don't need to go into the judging mind, you know, that I'm a hypocrite. You know, it's just, no, of course, there are incongruities. And kind of as a final note, there always will be. There always will be. This is not about becoming a perfect human being, you know, free of conditioning. It's not going to happen, right? But what's beautiful is it's an unfolding process, and this awakening process, this process of realization, to me seems very open-ended. Just continues to refine, continues to deepen, continues to enliven us as we come more and more attunement with who we really are. And so, you know, everyone we're with, whenever a reaction arises, either as a professional helper or not, is our teacher, right? Every situation, every challenge is inviting us to be more intimate and more awake with our experience. All right, I think we're up. All right, thank you very much.